Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A deputy sheriff is convicted of killing his lover, but he claims he is innocent. Edgar Cayce became famous in the 1920s when he diagnosed diseases while sleeping. Was it a special gift, or was it just luck? A college student vanishes during a party. Was he murdered, or did he simply walk away? For his entire life, Tim Harrell believed that he was abandoned by his birth mother. Then he learned the story was a lie, and now he wants to find her. There's nothing like a good mystery, and guess what? They're even better when they're true. I'm Dennis Farina. Join me, won't you? Gorman, Maryland, population 200. It was a typical workday for 19-year-old Kathy Ford. She was a waitress at her family's restaurant, the Old Mill. Around 2 o'clock, Kathy received a mysterious phone call and she left work early. She never returned. Paul Farrell, a former deputy sheriff, was convicted of her kidnapping and murder.
I did not kill Kathy Ford. I never hurt her in any way. They don't have any evidence that I did. And they have evidence that I made some mistakes. And I've admitted here that I did make some mistakes, but I never killed Kathy Ford or harmed her in any way whatsoever.
Paul's conviction was very unusual. Kathy's body was never found, and there was no proof that she was actually dead. In fact, two eyewitnesses claimed that they saw Kathy almost a year after Farrell was convicted. Paul Farrell lived in Gormania, West Virginia, just across the Potomac River from where Kathy lived.
Grant County Sheriff's Department, this is Deputy Farrell speaking.
The month before Kathy Ford disappeared, Farrell became a deputy sheriff in Grant County. He also rented a trailer just outside of town. Paul and Kathy were involved in a secret romance, even though each of them was seeing another person. Paul was seeing a local woman with two children. Kathy was involved with a man named Darvin Moon.
We had a lot in common because of our backgrounds and the fact that, you know, we both run businesses for our families. And we talk a lot about how some people irritated us. We talk about that. And, you know, she had a lot of plans, but she really couldn't do anything either because she was stuck there running the store for her family. Her family really depended on her.
Okay, do you know what time? Sure. Sure, I can do that.
The day Kathy disappeared, she got a phone call at around 1 p.m. Some say it was a tip-off. Supposedly, the sheriff was cracking down on local bars and restaurants for selling alcohol to minors.
Who was that on the phone?
I can't say. He'd lose his job.
Her mother had asked her a couple times, you know, where she was going, and she said she couldn't tell us. So Kathy left and went up to her house to shower. And when she came back down, she was dressed up.
Could you hand me my purse?
Yeah, sure.
And that's the last I saw her.
How do I look?
Around 2 p.m., Kathy drove off in her father's silver Bronco. At 8:30 that night, almost 7 hours later, Paul Farrell met with friends at a local bowling alley. There, he heard that a woman had been calling and asking for him.
I went over the payphone and made a call, and Kathy Ford answered real quickly there and started saying that she wanted to see me, that, and she seemed really upset. She was like crying and didn't seem herself. You know, I thought her voice was rather slurred.
No, I don't want to meet at the trailer.
And she'd mentioned that she really wanted to see me down at the trailer.
Look, we can meet at the high school in the parking lot. I'll be right there. Okay.
Farrell says he waited for Kathy at the high school parking lot for 20 minutes, but she never arrived. He had no idea that Kathy Ford's parents had already called the police and reported her missing. The next day, Kathy's family and her boyfriend, Darvin Moon, organized search parties and put up posters offering a reward. During the search, Darvin Moon talked to Paul Farrell outside the Old Mill restaurant. There was a story going around. Kathy had been seen the day before near Paul's trailer. Darvin also told Farrell that smoke from some unexplained source had been seen near his trailer. To Paul Farrell, it felt like an accusation. So, he decided to look around for himself. According to Farrell, he found Kathy's burnt-out car less than 200 yards from his trailer. At that point, he made a critical decision. He wouldn't tell anyone about the car. Farrell says that it was simply a matter of fear.
My initial thing was panic. I was afraid to even go close, afraid of what I might find, maybe. And how do I explain this? You know, she's dead, and she's dead in my backyard. You know, and all these people are searching, and they're talking about these big searches and about the vehicles in someone's backyard, and it's in my backyard.
Farrell says then he made another mistake that made him look even more guilty. He wrote an anonymous letter to the Old Mill restaurant, pretending to be Kathy. The letter said that she had run away and that she wanted her parents to know that she was safe. Farrell even enclosed $200 to help pay for the ruined Bronco. Initially, he denied sending the letter, but in court, an FBI handwriting expert proved that he had written it.
My idea was to stop the search for the vehicle, to avoid someone from going in there and finding that vehicle in my backyard, or finding what I thought maybe a body was back there, too. You know, I just panicked. I did an irrational thing, and I don't think it says guilt or anything else, but it was just something. Looking back, I don't have a real good explanation for it, just that I panicked.
Finally, almost 3 weeks after Kathy disappeared, Darvin Moon and Kathy's brother, Rich, found the missing Bronco. The FBI searched the area and found no trace of Kathy's body or any sign that she was ever there. Fire and rust had destroyed any fingerprints. Because the area around the Bronco was relatively uncharred, some people believe that the car was probably burned somewhere else. Paul Farrell's trailer was now the focus of the investigation. 8 days later, FBI agents tore up the newly laid carpet in Paul's master bedroom. They found traces of blood on the floor, wall, and ceiling. The most experts could say about the blood was that it was a woman's and that it was not inconsistent with the blood of Kathy's parents.
The blood was found in such places and in such quantities that it was obvious that some effort had been made to hide this particular evidence, linked with the kind of search that was conducted, the kind of efforts that were put forth by law enforcement people to find Kathy Ford, established that Kathy Ford was dead and that Kathy Ford was killed by some violent act.
They said, "We found blood in your trailer, Mr. Farrell. What do you got to say about that? It's all over the place, buckets of blood in there." And I said, and my reaction was, you know, bewilderment. I said, "Well, maybe, maybe someone cut their finger." You know, I didn't know what they were talking about. Maybe a speck here. I said, "Or the trailer's 8 years old. Maybe there's a speck or something."
The blood analysis proved nothing, but the engaging mathematical wizardry that was presented to the jury made that blood look like it was Kathy Ford's blood, when in fact we have no idea whose blood it belongs to. It's that simple.
Paul Farrell was formally charged with kidnapping, arson, and murder. Coming up, key witnesses claim the prosecution influenced their testimony against Paul Farrell. Nineteen-year-old Kathy Ford mysteriously disappeared after leaving work one afternoon. Paul Farrell was her secret lover. When police discovered Kathy's burnt-out car near Farrell's home, as well as blood in his bedroom, prosecutors charged him with murder. Now, it was up to the state to prove its case without a body. Farrell's trial began a little more than a year after Kathy disappeared.
What was your position there?
A bookseller.
Prosecutors discover that Farrell made hundreds of crank sex calls to businesses in the area. He called bookstores and libraries in several cities pretending to be a doctor. He asked these women to read the same sexually explicit passage.
It was a phone sex type thing to me. It had nothing to do with hurting anyone. It would be more the same of anyone calling a phone sex number. It's just I couldn't afford a credit card. And I look back and you know, it is wrong, and it's, but it was just something that had nothing to do whatsoever with Cayce Ford or anything.
Would you state your name, please?
Tamala Kitzmiller.
Other women testified that they had also received strange phone calls from a man who asked them to meet him in various locations.
Yes, I did.
Tamala Kitzmiller says that while she thought Paul Farrell might be the man who called her, she was never positive.
Prosecutors, prior to the original trial date, you know, they asked me not to elaborate on any doubts that I had, that they knew Paul Farrell was the caller and they could prove that. So I, you know, stated the information briefly. I did not elaborate on any doubts. And I waited for them to prove that Paul Farrell was the caller, and that did not happen.
Tamala also claimed that prosecutors told her that Farrell had been connected to a series of murders in Yellowstone Park, where he once worked.
They told me that he was a sicko and he needed to be put away. I was very influenced by that. Very influenced. You know, you have people in an official capacity who are telling you these things as if they're fact. And I waited for this information to come out in court, and it never did.
I know what we did, and I know we did not force anybody to say anything other than by subpoenaing them to come to court and testify.
Now, because of your specialized training,
as the trial progressed, the prosecution introduced some unusual testimony.
Yes, I do.
An FBI expert said that during Farrell's interrogation, he gave Farrell a hypothetical scenario about Cayce's murder. As Farrell was talking, the expert says that he saw signs of guilt in Farrell's body language.
I told Mr. Farrell that I believed that maybe something had happened, such as Cayce Ford had taunted him, teased him. Something had caused him to lose his temper. He had responded emotionally as opposed to rationally. And Mr. Farrell was nodding in this regard.
He said that I was basically nodding in agreement when I was simply telling him I understood. I knew what he was saying. You know, I understood what he was saying. Like, you're shaking your head right there. That was an admission of guilt. That was a confession, the way you shook your head just then.
This is the first time ever in the history of American criminal jurisprudence that this kind of evidence has ever been allowed to go to a jury that I'm aware of.
The evidence that I killed or kidnapped Cayce Ford, there's no evidence there, and they know it. And that's why they had to use the body language. That's why he had to make up a complete fabrication of that blood evidence. You know, because he had no evidence against me.
Additional evidence against Farrell came from his neighbor, Kim Nelson. Her home had a clear view of his trailer. She told prosecutors that she had heard screams coming from the trailer on several different occasions, even before Farrell moved in. She testified that one day she heard banging, a gunshot, and a woman's scream coming from the trailer. Today, however, she says prosecutors distorted her account.
Well, I told the cops that the only thing I heard was screaming and gunshots, which is normal up there, and that really I didn't know nothing about Paul Farrell killing anybody. That I didn't see nothing or hear anything.
Kim says that before the trial, she signed a statement typed up by the prosecutors without reading it. She later discovered that the statement said that she had heard screams on a specific day, when in fact she never mentioned a specific day.
Saying that if I didn't say what was on this paper, that I could go to jail. He goes that if Paul gets loose or he gets free, that he could come back and do harm to my kids and me.
No one in my presence, nor I at any time, ever tried to force her to say anything. I mean, I would have been totally out of my mind to have done that to a witness.
What was the nature of the screaming you heard?
It was a terrifying scream.
She answered the questions. She answered the questions honestly. And I'm still convinced that she was telling the truth. I think what's happening to her now is that she's just become involved in the aftermath of this whole thing and this refusal on the part of some of the family members and some of the community to believe that Paul Farrell is guilty.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, have you reached a verdict in this case?
Yes, we have.
Paul Farrell was found guilty of kidnapping, murder, and arson. He was sentenced to a minimum of 15 years in prison.
The court acted properly in what it did. Counsel did what they had to do. Paul Farrell got a fair trial. Basically, the jury did what it had to do, and that is it did justice and convicted Paul Farrell.
Journalist Martin Yant has reinvestigated all the aspects of this case.
I don't think that it was proved, certainly beyond a reasonable doubt, that Paul Farrell killed Cayce Ford.
Yant says that he has found two witnesses who are positive that they saw Cayce a year and a half after she disappeared. The witnesses lived near Cayce's hometown, but they were traveling through Tennessee.
Over there. Doesn't she remind you of somebody?
What impressed him was she seemed to be disturbed at the appearance of this couple, that she recognized them also. And when the waitress came over, she asked what he thought was a rather odd question for a restaurant right off a freeway. You seem to be strangers here. Where are you from? When she went back, she whispered something to this woman who looked like Cayce Ford, and she looked at them again and ran for the kitchen.
Well, we know Cayce's deceased. We would have heard something from her within a week if she was able to call or get word to us in some way.
Paul Farrell appealed his conviction twice to the West Virginia Supreme Court, but the court denied his appeals and ordered Farrell to finish serving his sentence. He was finally released after serving 18 years. Next, the amazing Edgar Cayce. Many believe he could diagnose a complicated disease while in a deep psychic trance. Cayce Kimura visited her ophthalmologist after having some minor vision problems. She was horrified when her doctor told her she had optic neuritis, a severe inflammation of the optic nerve. She was told that she would probably go blind.
It was a very frightening experience. They said I wouldn't run out right away and buy a white cane, but it's very serious, and I was scared. I mean, I suddenly realized that there was a possibility that I could go blind.
There is no known cure for the disease, so Cayce chose to look for an alternative treatment. She found a doctor who was familiar with the mysterious methods of a man named Edgar Cayce. Edgar Cayce became famous in the 1920s as a diagnostician, even though he had absolutely no medical training. In his lifetime, Cayce made more than 9,000 diagnoses, or readings as he liked to call them, while in a deep, self-induced trance. Even though Edgar Cayce died in 1945, many practitioners still follow his teachings. Some people dismiss the cures as a lucky coincidence or the power of suggestion. But try telling that to the people who believe that Cayce's methods actually cured them.
My father was a very ordinary person. He liked to garden, he liked to fish. We had gardens wherever we lived. He taught Sunday school. I mean, in everyday life, you wouldn't know him from anybody else. It was only when he was asleep that he had extraordinary ability.
Edgar Cayce discovered his mysterious ability when he was just 13 years old. A borderline student, one day he fell asleep on the top of his spelling book.
Kevin.
When his father later quizzed him, Edgar could spell every word in the book, and he even knew the page numbers where each word appeared.
Cattle,
from that time on, all he had to do was sleep on his books at night, and he moved along very rapidly, whether it was spelling or math or history or whatever. And he became an exceptional student rather than an average student.
When Edgar was 23, he suddenly lost the ability to speak. Doctors couldn't explain or cure his condition. As a last resort, Edgar's parents convinced him to see a hypnotist. His family physician attended and recorded the session in exact detail. When Edgar awoke from a deep hypnotic sleep, everyone was shocked. He spoke for the first time in a year.
He started to talk and say, yes, we have the condition, there's a constriction to the throat, constriction of the blood flow, so we will correct it. And when Lane, the hypnotist, told him to wake up, he sat up and coughed up a little blood and he could talk. And I think that was probably the first reading, though it was on himself.
Cayce's doctors convinced him to diagnose other patients who had not responded to traditional medicine. But within a short time, he became disillusioned when people tried to exploit his abilities.
At the end of some of the readings, people would start asking him questions about what horse was going to win a race, what was going to happen in the commodities, the stock market, the results of a ball game. And when he found out what had happened or what people were doing, he said, I'm giving it up.
Cayce stopped doing his psychic readings, got married, and moved to Alabama, where he worked as a photographer. By 1914, he had two sons, Edgar Evans and Hugh Lynn. When Hugh Lynn was just 8 years old, he was seriously injured in a darkroom explosion. The local doctor was not hopeful.
The doctors examined him and said, well, we think we're going to have to take out one eye. He's probably going to lose the sight in both of them. And a brother said, Daddy, give me a reading.
For Cayce, it was the ultimate test. He hadn't done a reading in years. Could he now save his own son from a life of blindness?
He described an application for the eyes that included tannic acid. Well, that was unheard of at the time, and the doctors thought it was too strong, but they thought he was going to lose his eyes anyway, so they wouldn't hurt to try it. And when they first put it on, well, you then said, this must be Daddy's medicine. It doesn't hurt.
It seemed like a miracle. Within 6 weeks, Yulin's sight was completely back to normal. Word of the boy's recovery spread, and soon Cayce was famous. In the 1920s, he moved to Virginia Beach and opened a center. Over the next 20 years, Cayce received thousands of requests for readings.
He felt like he couldn't refuse people, so he started doing 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, and he got up to, I understand, 9 or 10 a day. And it was just too much for him.
Near exhaustion, Edgar Cayce suffered a massive stroke. He died on January 3rd, 1945, leaving behind more than 120,000 pages documenting his readings. His work continues to offer hope to those in search of cures that have eluded modern medicine.
Kathy, an X-ray examination.
When Kathy Kimura's optic neuritis was diagnosed, she went to Dr. John Pagano, a chiropractor in New Jersey who had studied Edgar Cayce's readings for 30 years.
Cayce was very specific on what areas of the spine to adjust. The fact that Cayce suggested this certain procedure for eye problems does not mean that he specifically diagnosed it as optic neuritis. He talked about vision problems, blindness, and that's what I approached it, not as optic neuritis.
Kathy's eyesight was restored within 7 days. Dr. Picano believes that Cayce's treatments are responsible for her recovery, but skeptics disagree.
I think much of the Cayce material is based upon illusion, and I think there's a placebo effect here at work. Often, if you believe that someone is going to cure you, you give them white sugar pills, they might be cured. So the power of the mind can have a powerful effect.
I do believe in the power of the mind, and I tried to will the sight back before I had gone to Dr. Pagano, and it didn't work. And it was only after I had gone to Dr. Pagano and after he had adjusted my neck that the sight came back.
So, how can the unique life of Edgar Cayce be explained? The medical world refuses to endorse Casey's methods, yet at the same time, it is unwilling to dismiss them. Coming up, a popular college student goes to an all-night party. The next day, his keys and artwork are found in his car, and he has disappeared. The University of Idaho sits in the picturesque rural setting of Moscow, Idaho. Little out of the ordinary happens here, so when a local university student suddenly vanished, the town was in shock.
People don't disappear around here. Murders don't happen. You know, I can name them on one hand in the last 20 years.
At 25, Will Hendricks seemed very happy about where he was headed. He was well-liked in the drama department and had a good job on campus. Some believe his disappearance may be related to the fact that he was openly gay. But for now, all we know for sure is that he disappeared after a college party. That evening began with hard work. Will and his partner of 5 years, Jerry, were remodeling their kitchen.
Well, Katie's party's tonight and we're going, right?
Will decided he wanted to go to Katie's party.
I'm too tired.
I didn't want to go. I wanted to go to sleep.
Come on.
And at about midnight, he said, okay, I'm going to go and I'll be home in a few hours. I'll see you in a few hours.
Hey, Katie.
When Will arrived, there were two parties in full swing. On the third floor were mostly former athletes from the local high school. At Katie's party, on the second floor were friends from the theater department.
Because of the two different worlds that were kind of colliding that night, my concern was that there could be a possibility for some sort of confrontation, since Will has no problem being open with how he is and with every opinion.
Okay, I'm a little worried about Karen, okay? I don't like that guy.
That night, Will was concerned about another friend, Karen. Karen was having trouble with her boyfriend, who was at the party on the third floor.
Good, I'll cause you a scene. Let me go. I'll push you all I want. Let go of me.
There were times when, if he'd had a bit to drink, he'd get belligerent. If somebody yelled a slur at him, he'd respond. He'd take the bait.
By 2:30 a.m., Karen had gone home, leaving Katie to keep Will from getting into trouble.
I'm going upstairs.
No, you're not.
Yes, I want to go upstairs.
No, you don't.
Katie left to make sure that Karen got home safely. When she returned, okay. Will was gone.
Will? Will?
Katie noticed Will's car was still parked out front and just assumed that he had gone upstairs. By the next morning, his car was also gone.
It was about 11:30, 12 o'clock when I called Katie's. And I said, can you wake Will up and send him home? We've got some stuff to do today. And she said, well, he's not here. He didn't stay here last night. And I started calling around to all the theater students, trying to find out if he'd gone to somebody else's house, continued drinking, passed out on their couch. And nobody had seen him.
He called about 7:30 Sunday evening. And he was concerned, and I was immediately concerned. It was winter, and my initial concern was hypothermia.
When Will hadn't shown up by Monday morning, his friends began to search for him.
Find anything?
Nothing down here.
A big break came when they found his car parked on a downtown street.
Found
I did.
Jerry, Will's partner, was surprised to find that it was unlocked and that Will had left his portfolio inside the car.
That portfolio carried all of Will's artwork, his drawings, his makeup sketches. Everything that was important to him was in that portfolio.
On the dashboard were his work keys from the university.
Here are his keys right here.
We did go through the car with a fine-tooth comb with crime lab folks. There weren't any blood or any hair samples that weren't Will's. There wasn't anything in there that would indicate that any kind of foul play occurred, at least in the car.
Finding the car only raised more questions about Will's disappearance. Some of his friends thought it was possible that perhaps Will just left voluntarily to start a new life.
Will had a lot of trepidation about school, and I think he shared that with me because we had that in common. Sometimes you just get overwhelmed, and his comment was, you know, I'd like to tour the country. I'd just like to take off someday. And I was like, wow, and not tell anyone? No, I said, you know, not even your parents? You know, what about your commitments? He said, well, I'd just go.
I spent probably about a year hoping, praying that he had walked away, because the alternative was he was dead.
My hypothesis, I guess you should say, is that something happened and it got out of control and it probably didn't mean to happen, but then whatever happened got covered up simply because it became so huge.
I could see that this might have been a possibility, that he ran into somebody that didn't like gays and they did him in. We did interview all of the folks on the top floor and did not get any indication from any of them that they had done anything other than just talk to Will. Subsequent to our initial contact with them, those individuals on the top floor took a polygraph, and all of them did pass the polygraph.
Jerry believes that Will's car offered the best clues.
I found out that there was mud caked on the inside wheel wells of the car. So there was no reason for mud to be caked on the inside of the wheel wells. And then the other odd thing was that somebody had moved the seat all the way to its far back position, indicating to me that a large person may have been the last person to drive Will's car.
Jerry was desperate for answers. He pursued a theory that someone they both knew might have crossed Will's path early that January morning. 2 months before Will disappeared, Jerry had fired a van driver who worked for his shuttle service. The man got angry and used a sexual slur.
Get off the property! I don't want you here again!
He subsequently went to work for a long-haul trucking outfit. And on the morning of Will's disappearance, at approximately 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, he checked out a refrigerated truck from the dispatch in Lewiston, 30 miles south of here. There is a coincidence there in that the last time Will was seen was about the time this driver would have been going to Lewiston.
We have had a number of sightings across the country. The people call us up and say, hey, we have seen Will. We have checked each and every one of those calls out, and they have not proven to be Will. We have checked out hundreds of leads, put in hundreds and hundreds of hours on this particular case. And as far as absolute facts that we can lay down on a piece of paper to show what may have happened, we are no closer than we were on day one. I don't know that it's important to find him, because if he's dead, and I believe that he is, I know where he's at. But I think having a body can really definitely put some closure.
Update. More than 2 years after Will disappeared, two hunters found his skull and jawbone in a rural area outside of Moscow, Idaho. No other remains were found. The cause of death could not be determined, but police believe Will was murdered. They also suspect that Will knew who his attacker was. If you have any information about Will Hendricks' murder, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a veteran journalist searches for his mother, who supposedly left him in a garbage can when he was just a few days old. Tim Harrell is a veteran journalist. He's covered thousands of stories, but solving his own personal mystery has been his toughest assignment.
Hi, Bill. Tim Harrell over Channel 13 News.
It's so frustrating to know that here I am. I can go out and get good stories. I can break stories. I can do great interviews. I can get nominated for Emmys. I can win awards. But I can't find my mother.
Tim was raised by a woman named Helen Harrell. She never made a secret of the fact that Tim was adopted or the tragic details of his early life.
She told me that she had found me abandoned in a garbage can behind Barnes Hospital in St. Louis, where she worked as a nurse. And that when she found me, I was very sick. I had a birth defect known as a cleft palate and a hair lip. And she took me in and had a plastic surgeon repair that. I also had rheumatic fever, which was a heart problem, where I had a heart murmur as well. And she took care of that.
Helen somehow managed to adopt him at a time when choosing to be a single parent was almost unheard of.
She always was concerned that there was never a male force in my life, so she made sure I was in military school. She made sure I was in the YMCA. She made sure I was in Little League, and she went to these things with me. I mean, she went to the Little League games with me. She went to the YMCA with me. She took the role of being father and mother.
But then came the day when Tim wanted to know more about his past.
Mom?
Yes?
What happened to my mother?
She and your father were low class. Trashy.
Her favorite term for them was white trash.
No way of taking care of you.
I just hated my birth mother. I thought, my God, how could a human being just throw away a baby, particularly one who had a physical defect, and just throw him in the garbage like it was a piece of garbage? I mean, that just gnawed away at me. And as I got into journalism, as I did stories about mothers who abandoned their children, you know, I always lumped my birth mother in with them. And they were always usually people that were low class, that had no caring for their children, and I would always identify my birth mother with those people.
When Tim was in his late 20s, he got a job at a Los Angeles newspaper. By then, he was married and had a son of his own. And that summer, Tim received a phone call.
City desk.
May I speak to Tim Harrell?
Speaking. Who's calling?
This is your mother.
Excuse me? What are you talking about? My mother's at home.
This is your mother. Your real mother.
It came right out of the blue like a bolt of lightning. I mean, I've been through riots. I covered things in Vietnam. But that just was the most emotional thing that I've ever had in my life, to get that phone call.
Don't you think it's a little late to suddenly be taking an interest in my life?
I'm sorry about what I did to you, but there are things you don't understand.
All of a sudden, all the hatred just exploded. I said, how could you? How could you throw me away like I was a piece of garbage? How could you do that? And she said, well, you don't understand. And I said, I don't want to understand.
I'd like to see my grandson.
There's no way you're ever going to see my son.
All the emotions just flowed out of me. The city editor who was working there looked at me and he says, my God, what's wrong? You look like you've seen a ghost. And I told him I have.
Later that day, Tim told his adopted mother about the call, and she became quite upset.
You're not going to try and see her, are you?
Of course not. I have no interest in seeing her or my father. I told him to stay away from my family.
Helen's reaction convinced him that he was making the right decision to keep his birth mother out of his life. A couple of years later, Helen died. Tim got divorced and then remarried. And even though he was happy with his life, Tim couldn't shake the feeling that something was wrong. On a trip back to St. Louis, Tim and his wife tried to locate his birth mother through adoption records, but he was told that the files were confidential.
She said adoptions in Missouri are confidential, and we played sort of a game of 20 questions, if you will. She says, think Bay Area. I said, San Francisco. She says, no, a little further south. And I said, San Jose? She said, yes. She says, think relative of your mother, of your adoptive mother. Couldn't think of who that would be.
Listen, I'm gonna go get a cup of coffee. Seems silly to put this away, just to get it out again later. I'm gonna be gone for about 5 minutes.
In those 5 minutes, Tim learned that Helen had lied about every detail of his life. His birth mother was not some cold-hearted stranger who had thrown him into a garbage can. She was apparently Helen's own niece, and she had given Tim up only because she had to.
It went through me like a jolt of electricity. The only thought in my mind was, is I really wanted to find her now. I really wanted to say, look, I didn't know, and I am so sorry.
Tim learned that Helen's niece was just 18 when he was born. His father had just gotten out of the army and was in no position to be both a husband and a father. They gave Tim to Helen and quietly walked away.
You may have lived in the St. Louis area back in 1947 or so.
I have to find this woman. Even if it turns out that she has died, I'd want to go to the grave. I'd want to talk to her. I didn't give her an opportunity to explain. Here I am a journalist. I'm supposed to be fair. I'm supposed to be even-handed. I'm supposed to listen to both sides, and I wouldn't even give my real mother the opportunity to explain what happened. To this day, I'm very worried that I don't have that opportunity.
Update. When we aired this story, a private investigator named Alice Simon from Scottsdale, Arizona, was watching. She volunteered to help Tim with his search, and within 1 week, she had found Tim's mother. Tim's birth mother, Muriel Gartner, lives in Campbell, California. She gathered her entire family to welcome Tim and his son, Adam, home at last.
I'm never crying. Yeah.
There's always been the hole, an empty hole. Though I've had a lot of other kids in a wonderful life, great kids. But it feels like this hole's beginning to fill in now.
This is your brother, Joe.
Joe, how are you?
I'm your cousin.
Welcome.
It's just the most amazing feeling in the world to know that I've got this family and that I'm going to be a part of this family and that they're going to be a part of my life. And I mean, I just can't tell you what the feeling is like.
He's just one of us. And it felt that way from the very beginning when he called me. He said, hello, Mom, and I said, hello, son, and that was it. When we went to hang up, he said, can I call you again tomorrow, Mom? I've been wanting to call my mom for a long time, and I cried, and he cried.